Today's episode is literally to die for, and you're going to want to stick around for it.
I don't think that our relationships are cut when people die. I think they are just, you need to rebuild them. You need to create a new framework for this relationship you have with this person who passed away.
Generally, the topic is stigmatized, and it believes that if you talk about it, you bring the bad luck, and you speed up it, and you will die soon.
Parents talking about death with their kids in an environment where the children just don't ever confront death throughout their childhoods, right?
That's one of my favorite topics.
Hopefully the people facing their deaths, they give us a hint what they want. For my death, I want to be prepared.
What I usually tell parents is just to start talking about it, because you will be very bad at it at first.
At the moment, there are so many really cool utopian ideas popping up all over the world, and I'm really happy that people start thinking again about what burial actually is.
Welcome to Standard Time, a Eurozine production. I'm your host, Reka Kingapop, editor-in-chief of said Eurozine, which is also a co-founder of the Display Europe platform, offering you European content in 15 languages. Check it out. Today, we remember that we too shall die one day. And in order to do so well, we have a lot to consider. Since this show is a digital production, you get to watch it on your own time, your respective standard time, so use your time well. Now, if you've lost someone dear to you, you probably know that grief is a very peculiar stream whose strength ebbs and flows and extends over a long time. That's the thing about grief, though. It isn't linear and has no fixed shelf life. Yet, in Western culture, one is expected to get over it and move on at some point. Grieving is often seen as an individual endeavor, and if it lasts for over 12 months, it's labeled prolonged grief disorder. Whereas in places like Egypt, you can keep crying over someone for like 7 years and it's still considered normal. Across East Asia and the Mediterranean, professional mourners are hired to accompany the dead person's family and community. This tradition was popular with wealthy families during the Victorian era at funeral processions in Western Europe as well. In places like Indonesia, crying is not encouraged, and many rituals around the world choose to celebrate the deceased person's life through joy and dance instead, or even in spite of the pain of their loss. The great equalizer that is death varies throughout Europe as well, from the solemnity of a Catholic funeral in Italy to the joyous celebrations in Spain's Day of the Dead. The continent embraces a wide spectrum of approaches to bid farewell to loved ones. But let's be frank, European cultural practices around death have also rapidly changed with the last few decades of globalization. For my grandparents, it was totally normal to go to the graveyard up to 2 or 3 times a week to tend to the burial site of a spouse or a parent, or even their own in advance. I should know, I used to accompany them with my sisters, and we would rake patterns in the sand around the graves, and we would compete to the well to get the water for the flowers. Anyway, all I'm saying is that not so long ago, death used to be a part of everyday life. Throughout human history, it has always been heavily ritualized, and it has always occupied our imaginations. Death plays a key role in most religions, moral systems, and even legal constructs. When it comes to believing in life after death, there's also a huge discrepancy in percentage. Check out this map. In Germany, cremation is a common practice and is seen as a form of natural burial, even though many activists draw attention to its high emission levels of both CO2 and toxic fumes. There is a growing movement towards more nature-friendly technologies, reflecting a shift in European attitudes towards death and environment. Instead of elaborate coffins and heavily polluting embalming chemicals, some people choose biodegradable materials and eco-friendly practices, allowing their bodies to return to the earth in a harmonious cycle of life and death. That's pretty much what Jews and Muslims have been doing for literal ages. Green Death Tech is a growing industry that offers a wide range of options to perish. A mushroom suit, in space, underwater, you got it. There's human composting, water cremation, or as the kids say, aquamation, and so much more. That is, if you can afford it, because death is also an economic question. Most burial practices are extremely expensive, and their financing can sometimes bankrupt grieving families, rendering it a social issue too. While mourning and bereavement are all sentiments that transcend borders, within the EU's confines, they are a contested topic. The peril of refugees trying to make their way into Europe has flooded Mediterranean shores with unforeseeable numbers of dead, prompting people to ask the question, are all lives really seen as worth the same? Are we really equal in death? Death has always been and continues to be politically instrumentalized, and activists from all ends of the left and right spectrum shape the societal spheres they are in through it. From anti-abortion activists who use the argument of pro-life to push for legislation that controls women's bodies and sometimes endangers their lives, to euthanasia advocates who want to give people the chance to choose when and how they want to die with dignity. Now, I don't know about you, but unlike the alchemists and scientists bidding for immortality, I'd rather come to terms with the reality of death, and I think it would benefit our societies too. Us Europeans, we tend to avoid conversations that make us feel uncomfortable. But if we don't talk about the imminent ending of life, how are we going to learn and teach future generations how to deal with it or appreciate life, really? So, and I can't believe I'm saying this, but let's be more like the Danish and talk about death. Let's get to it with our guests. Anastasia Smirnova recently received her MA in architecture from the University of Applied Arts in Vienna, working on her project Circumitus. The initiative places small pavilions at the Vienna Central Cemetery to support grieving individuals and to introduce fresh rituals that alter our traditional perceptions of cemeteries. Stefan Dinges is a theologian, consultant, mediator, and medical ethicist at the Institute for Ethics and Law in Medicine at the University of Vienna. He is part of the team at Letzte Hilfe Österreich, providing courses to the public on end-of-life assistance and care for the dying. Yvonno, Leeb buries and lectures on the topics of process-oriented burials, caring for the dead, as well as queer death. They have been working in funerals since 2019 and helped design the Undertaker training program in the Berlin-based nonprofit organization Kulturtreue, offering educational and cultural programs on death. They are also one of the co-founders of Tamo Burials in Vienna. Originally an architect and interior designer, Noémi Ambrózy changed her career path after becoming a mother of two hearing-impaired children. She is a certified grief educator and instructor at Hand-in-Hand Parenting. As a professional, she works with the losses and specific challenges of everyday life through inner strength and community building. She is representing the Hungarian Solar Eclipse Association, whose main objectives are to help the bereaved and research issues on grief. Hi, very welcome. Thanks for coming in on this nice rainy day to talk about death. I wanted to start by addressing the taboo, this very sort of European North American taboo around talking about death. For instance, Noémi, you work with people and talk with them about their own deaths, the deaths of their relatives. How do they react? How do you cross this boundary?
It's easier for me because they come and ask. So they are already somehow connected to death. But I see in the questions that they are not really mindful in their everyday life about death and how to talk about death with your family. It's a good thing to talk about in everyday life too, but it's not usual. Maybe dying in general, it is better, but every time you talk about dying in general, you think about your own death or your family's death. So it immediately comes very close to heart. Death is very, very elemental part of being human, actually.
Stefan, you came wearing an actual memento mori. Can you show it to the camera, please, your T-shirt?
It's like a peep show a little bit. Everybody dies, is the last sentence.
So I've heard, indeed. So when you meet with people in like consulting situations, for instance, how do they react? I like to think about death. I don't like to think about my own death, to be honest.
So First, I think talking about death is not so much a problem than talking about the dying process. I'm talking to physicians at the end of life treatment, and there it's quite necessary to remind them nearly everybody dies. We try to create, to support the dying process. And therefore we have to talk and we have to look on medical facts, we have to look on the personal will of the patient and the people caring for the patient.
And I think the whole medical field has this weird paradox that death is inherently part of the medical profession, but the point of medical care most often is to avoid it, right? So it has a kind of interesting conundrum to integrate this.
In the texture of Hippocrates, you have everything but not death is mentioned there. So the physicians were not in charge of the dying process. That was the priest. Now the physicians or the medical team has to do all the roles, and that's quite difficult.
So as a theologian, and you know, we're going to move on, but we have to address this. You are wearing so many hats in this situation. Most religions are very strongly centered around death and afterlife and legacy and memory and transcendency. So I guess for you, that is a completely different or maybe even opposite perspective, right?
Religion is very much linked to spiritual and existential needs. And therefore, of course, theology is a resource.
Thank you. Yvonno, you bury people, you're an undertaker, but you also have a strong focus on the queer burial. If somebody has never heard of this as an issue, how do they imagine? What's peculiar about the queer burial? How does this differ from any other burial?
Yeah, I'm not sure actually if there are specific needs. I think there are certain circumstances that are challenging for queer people when they die, that actually the legal situation of being buried is very, like, it's structured in a heteronormativity. So the biological family is always prior to laws. The traditional burials we know or the ceremonies are often come from a context and time that was very hurtful for queer people.
I think this is a very interesting question about who owns the death or the dead person, or, you know, legally also who has authority above the body, but who owns their memory or their memorialization and how we go about this. And we can see certain ways, sometimes even really funky ways of like very sort of celebrating the individual, their personality, expressing something out of it. There are, of course, more traditional or differently situated ways where it's more about the community and their place in the community. And I think it's very interesting. But what I hear very intensely from what you're saying is that this spiritual gap that you name here between older timey traditions, it's also interesting to think about the infrastructure that we use around death. And Anastasia, this is where your work comes in. You as an architect think about the graveyard and what's available there and how it could better support people with their grief.
The green burial is believed to be the best way in the future because the carbon dioxide footprint is much lower, because in the process of the of the coffin creation, it takes like much less sources, and there are biodegradable materials that are used, which helps to decompose the body much faster. And there are like the other ways, like water cremation, that is a bit more toxic, but still it's much better than the regular cremation, which releases a lot of carbon dioxide as well.
I guess it's about land use, though, especially in big metropolitan centers. The size of cemeteries, which were originally planned, most of these graveyards were planned a long time ago. There isn't infinite space to expand, and real estate and land is extremely valuable. So people think about minimizing the space we use. But cremation emits a lot of toxic fumes and has huge CO2 emissions as well. But also, Yvonne, please, speak to me about the unspeakable.
In my work, most of the times people are already died, you know. What is actually unspeakable is that the emotional content is always kind of put away. And I feel we don't have a culture around actually addressing these feelings and these emotions and hold them and work with them and stabilize them. So in my work, when we do process-oriented burials, we actually put the focus on this emotional work. And I think the navigation of feelings is actually our historical, our political, our personal compass of dealing with death and dying.
At the funeral stage of grieving, they have to think about how, where, from what money will we bury our loved ones. And this is a very different mindset than the one when they can allow themselves to grieve. Grieving and feelings usually comes later. And it's not a rule, but usually this is the case.
And now, some words from today's host. As we're nearing the end of the season, I'd like to say a huge thank you to the Alte Schmiede Kunstverein for hosting the talk show many times throughout this year and helping us try our wings in their midst. The Alte Schmiede is an independent, non-profit institution that promotes literature and art and supports artists in realization of non-profit making projects. Quite like us. Thanks, Alte Schmiede, and a big old thank you to Walter Famla.
Individual rituals need a lot of energy. And as you mentioned, it could be stuck in the grieving process if it's right now. And it could be a burden to ongoing grieving. So for me, there is no right or wrong. And hopefully the people facing their deaths, they give us a hint what they want.
The burial sites are very heavily structured by authorities. And here's when Anastasia's work comes in, because you have proposed interventions in these spaces in the form of sort of pavilions. Tell us about how this works. What's the thought process there?
Yeah, but it was mostly structured in around the concept of the grieving circle. And I didn't really deal with bodies, because still it's a huge taboo, the topic of death generally and how you dispose a body. But I was focused on the like relatives and how we deal with the grieving. There are a lot of tombstones that's supposed to be removed, because like if you didn't know here, you just like take the like spot just like to the rent, so you don't buy it, because like in my home country, you just buy it once and you just like do whatever with it. But here they just like take the person out, they throw the stone, they bury the person like much deeper, and then they put the other.
So it's like an aggregate of all those things arriving in a cemetery, losing their initial purpose and sort of finding a new life,
yeah,
or a new purpose in a bit of a sort of mourning space, right?
I try to repeat the process of like the green burial when the body comes back to the nature. So like I just took the materials that uses and like took it back to the nature, sort of like using it.
That's really interesting. Yvonno, you have mentioned to me before that how we understand a green burial is not a self-explanatory thing. So green burials might mean very different things to people. How so? Is there not a definition in a lexicon? Come on.
At the moment, there are so many really cool utopian ideas popping up all over the world. And I'm really happy that people start thinking again about what burial actually is. And so many different ideas of green burials come up, again, depending on the region and the climate conditions. Working in Vienna, I have to follow certain rules and regulations. And so I'm trying to look what I have here and how can I improve the situation, what materials are really necessary.
What I imagine as the ultimate green burial, which is like the body in a shroud, put directly in the ground, is not a green option in certain climates. Like right here, that's not a green version. How so? Why do we need the box?
We need the oxygen. We need the oxygen to recompose. If we wouldn't have a coffin, then we wouldn't have this protection where the oxygen is inside, and so we would be stuck in our transition, actually, and that's a big problem of the graveyards in Europe. So we do not recompose because we use plastic, because we use polish on the coffin, and this is actually not helpful for our transitions in death. I would like to go back to this, how can we foster dialogues? Because I think it's very important that we cultivate a language around death and dying that is actually not traumatizing. And I think we need to cultivate a language that is sensitive and is not distancing us from dead people.
And to normalize it, not to be such a strange thing. It happens to everybody. So we have to care for that in front.
Death scares people. It's fine. It's fine to be scared of your own death. It's fine to sort of feel baffled by it to some extent. The question is whether you hide away from this or whether you address it, sort of go towards the frightening thing. Parents talking about death with their kids in an environment, especially in like very urban environments, where the children just don't ever confront death throughout their childhoods, right?
That's one of my favorite topics because I think we can learn a lot when we are parenting children, because they are asking about death. They are not very concerned about our feelings about death. So they are always asking. They will ask us, when will you die? Or when will grandma die? And what I usually tell parents is just to start talking about it, because you will be very bad at it at first. Trying it with a three-year-old, you will be getting better when they are growing up, and actually you will have meaningful conversations with a teenager.
I also happen to have the theory that talking about death with kids is pretty similar to talking about sex with kids. So what you need is not the talk, because if I need to tell teenagers 100,000 times to wash their freaking armpits for them to actually understand what that means, then I probably also have to talk with them on multiple occasions about these much more complex things. It's a process for them to understand as well. So you don't have to be good at this.
We have also last 8 courses, and we did one of these courses 10 days ago for kids and teens. The 8 till 12 years old, there we have to address the very emotional part and to develop, to have no fear in that situation and to take it as a normal thing in life when people getting older and in their dying process. Starting from 14, it's their right to know what happens. It's so amazing to see what happens. And we have also so short videos when the kids are reporting what happened to them in these 4 hours.
If you want to know more about European news and affairs and see what the Display Europe portal has to offer, check out Vox Europe's press review articles and short video recaps.
What hides behind the newly uncovered Russian influence campaign known as the Voice of Europe? Pavel Bartushek reviews the situation in partnership with Display Europe.
Display Europe's newsletters provide information and updates about DisplayEurope.eu, a groundbreaking media platform anchored in public values, built by independent not-for-profit media organizations from across Europe. Late kindergarten, maybe early school, when kids are obsessed with death. And then teens, it's all about gore and gothic emotions, because you're going through this big emotional transformation. Your whole person is transforming. As I mentioned, basically your brain is melting down and you're growing another one. The whole idea of suicide and control over your life comes in, which is, of course, I mean, no parent wants to think of suicide in the context of their kids. The bigger the taboo, the less they are likely to talk with us when they are in trouble. When we talk about suicide, it does remind me of the very sort of gore effect that suicide, especially amongst trans people, but in the LGBT community overall, in these up until the ages of, let's say, middle ages, it's much higher in ratio. So that says to me that there are problems that would have been better addressed. Is there something that you can offer the grieving family or anything specific in such a case?
Like, we also have this non-profit organization, Kulturtrauer. We do workshops with different age groups, like from school seminars to university to different professions where we focus more on the connection between grief and death. It's still stigmatized in society. It's still treated differently. And I think it's important to take a closer look at these stigmas. What do you need to say goodbye to people who decided to walk away, to pass away? What do you need to somehow continue your life with this experience? It's a big topic in the queer community. How do we handle the grief around these death, but also how do we look at our society? What is the actual reason for these fights? What makes it harder for queer people to live?
Before the decision to make suicide, then we have to address some issues like we need all these ideas and to bring them together, not to judge about them, but to say, let people help to live their life meaningful and dignified. A lot of young people lost meaning in their life. Now we have with the new law in Austria, we set up the right to get assistance if there's the decision made for suicide. Now we have to really to put all these ideas and these rituals together to unify these processes. Yeah, I have the right to say it's enough. And not only at the end of the life, but my focus is end of life decision making.
I wanted to go back a little bit about the language around death. And before it was totally taboo, nobody was talking about it. And right now it is more visible, let's say it like that. The way we are talking about it, the language is changing. We usually use the expression death by suicide.
Yeah, because oftentimes a decision to end one's life is considered like a tally at the end of the, you close the books and you say, this was a failure, which is a very cruel and really like mean, simplistic way to talk about a life, right?
Usually the decision to take your own life takes like 5 minutes. This is what I usually talk about with families, that they are not responsible and there was no way to stop it.
I would like to come back to Anastasia. I've heard a little bit about your experiences and journeys, but Anastasia, how do you come to this topic as an art student? It's like, you're frolicking in the woods among dandelions and all that, and suddenly you think, I want to deal with death. What's your journey in landing on this project?
Somehow it happened organically. I started with memorization and memories and like human itself. And like
which is basically applied arts throughout the ages,
yeah,
right?
That's true.
I want a big old statue of me in front of the Borg, if you're asking me.
That's true.
And so you start with memorialization.
I ask the people like about their favorite memories or like the special smell they remember. Because I tried to like address all feelings, and after that I came to the like the visualization of their memories through the AI and some like VR tools. And after that I needed the site, because I'm like, by the end of the day I'm an architect, so I need to do something with it. And then I thought like, okay, well, what is dealing with memories? Death and cemetery. So yeah.
In the cultural context where you first met death, where you grew up, how is that different? How would you describe your original sort of cultural impact around death?
Generally, the topic is stigmatized, and like it believes that if you talk about it, you bring the bad luck, and you like in a way you speed up it, and you will die soon. So that's why like no one talks about death. In terms of like cemetery, it's a bit more creepy because like I'm from Eastern Europe, and like there are like pictures of the people all the time you walk there, and like my parents are from small villages, and you walk and they're like, okay, it's my friend, like this one is my teacher, and you like hear all those crazy stories, and like you see this like personal attitude of your parents towards like the pictures of the people.
Is it okay if you name where you grew up?
Yeah, sure. Russia.
And where within Russia?
It's like the middle of Russia, but it's Islamic Republic. So we have like separated Muslim cemeteries and like separated Christian ones.
let me introduce you to the work of our friend and colleague Claire Potter, a professor of history emeritus at the New School of Social Research and the co-executive editor of Public Seminar, one of Eurozine's partner journals. Her blog, Political Junkie, and podcast, Why Now?, are available to read and listen to on Substack, and she's fantastic. Find her under clairepotter.substack.com. Hi, Claire. There has been some publishing about the Russian culture's death drive, what one of our authors, Anton Chekhovtsov, we'll cite him in the show notes, calls political immortalism. Is this idea to sort of build a memory for yourself is such a strong motive in political actions. And then weirdly in private life, this seems to be sort of on the contrary, oftentimes with people who, for instance, don't want to think about their deaths, as you mentioned, like your mother-in-law. But it does inform the sort of political or moral choices.
Crazy what's coming up. I was married to a Russian for some years. And I remember the visiting of one Moscow cemetery, and it was so much in their mind who was buried there, and all the history was present. Yeah, that was for hours. Yeah, I'm not able to go to Vienna Central Cemetery and know all the stories, but even if I would try. Yeah, and that was so much linked to culture and historical identity, I guess. So, yeah.
It's the same in Hungary, because we have these cemetery walks when you are visiting all the famous people with a guide, and it's a thing there too. So maybe it's when you have a smaller community, you are more mindful of who is buried there.
The Vienna Central Cemetery, when it was designated, this was way away from downtown, and people wouldn't want to be buried there. Some of the day's biggest celebrities were taken out of their graves and brought to the Vienna Central Cemetery, so the bourgeoisie would want to be buried near them. So I believe Beethoven is one of these who were sort of moved over there to attract an audience, to want to buy the parcels.
And I would really love to see that graveyards and cemeteries are getting more integrated in our public life. I think it would be so nice if there would be spaces to just be and hang out. I think this is one of the misconceptions that I'm facing in my work, that dead people are somehow dangerous and need to be isolated. And I think that's absolutely not true. And it's like also the infrastructure around dead people is very isolating. Like, for example, in Vienna, there are no rooms where you can actually do the last care. Like, there could be a little nice cafe or something. I don't think that our relationships are cut when people die. I think they are just, you need to rebuild them. You need to create a new framework for this relationship you have with this person who passed away. And the time you spent there or the rituals you do, these are your new memories. Like, this is kind of the start of the new connection you have.
We were in the Philippines, and they bury some of their relatives in the garden. Sunday, they go on the grave, sitting around and having a barbecue.
In Copenhagen, in the Central Cemetery, which is this like spectacular, beautiful, you know, series of parks, that's a main tourist attraction. And there's young parents with the prams walking around with babies and dog walkers, and people are jogging without the barbecue, unfortunately. Yeah. I guess it's probably the weather.
We also have a saying in Hungarian that someone walked over your grave, and it's when you shiver. It's usually not connected with a good feeling. To be connected and to have pavilions and have gatherings inside the cemetery would be a very nice way to connect, because this is one thing a griever has to learn, that the love didn't die.
And I think this is one of the key aspects of process-oriented burials, to focus on that, like to do the emotional work of what do you need to build up this new connection. I think this experience is actually an active process, and it's important to find a way to express yourself and to actively live your grief, actually.
In my mind, I think I could really use some kind of a notion where somebody has completed living. Mm-hmm. And it's just, you know, it's a loss, but it's also sort of a great ending.
A method called dignity therapy. And it's a last interview of people in their last days and weeks.
Okay, last words. Befittingly, let's go a quick round. How do we each want to die?
I do it okay. With a glass of red wine in my hand.
Okay, that's a nice image.
I want to be with my family at home. And I want to be at the place what I love.
I think in the air somehow, like, I want to feel this, like flying moment, because as a human, you cannot really do it.
I think I want to die in water.
Thank you so much. It's been so much fun. I'm not surprised, to be honest, because whoever works in this field is going to be very enthusiastic about this. But thank you so much. This program is presented by Eurozine, an online magazine bringing you reads from more than 100 partner publications and across dozens of European languages. This talk show is a co-production with the Viennese Okto TV, and it's a Display Europe production. Display is a content sharing platform offering you content on politics, culture, community, and so much more. And somehow, miraculously, also doesn't abuse your user data. I know, it's a shocker. Now, if you like our graphics and want more, or just like what you see and wish to support our work, please go to patreon.com/eurozine. That is Eurozine, the magazine presenting this show. You can pledge as little as 5 euros a month, or whatever you can afford, to keep our show going. You'll also get access to bonus materials, invitations to the tapings of the show, we just got a second season, and even get to suggest topics and questions. This program is co-funded by the Creative Europe Program of the European Union and the European Culture Foundation. Importantly, views and opinions expressed here are those of the authors and the speakers only, and they do not necessarily reflect those of the European Union or the European Education and Culture Executive Agency. Neither the European Union nor the EACEA can be held responsible for them. We also thank the Alte Schmiede Kunstverein for hosting us.